Oops. Salt, 40. So this is not for. No, no. Do you want? I can give you this one. And oh yes. This is.
Thanks.
If you don't need it, then.
I spoiled that after walking with my laptop.
Ah, you don't have one. Okay. So yeah, this might be a bit confusing now because this does not apply to this. Yes.
By the way, if you need to write anything, let me know.
Yeah.
Because this vote is not with usual.
Ah, yeah. Okay. Delayed annotations. Do you want to continue? Ah, yeah. Yes. So if you're logged on to, if you're logged into the machine, into the local computers, then open a browser and go to this address, hub.vasp.at. And there you should be able to log on using the stuff on the little slip that I gave you. Sorry. Bad. Here you go, and here. Does it work? Ah, yes, very good. So you have, yeah.
Entrance key and the no entrance key or it in the computer class.
Oh, sorry. Okay. I understand. So. I will also try to do that here. So, and to start, you can open a terminal. You can always open an additional one by clicking on this plus. And yeah, once you have a terminal, you can download or install the workshop material. So, oops. Yeah, there's a few things. So these are the this you would enter into your terminal. So you make a directory that you call workshop, then you enter into it and you move the MD tutorials, or you copy the MD tutorials to this directory and unzip it. We still have to figure out a way to set up the virtual machines in such a way that this is automatically updated for everybody.
The URL for the course materials, the website where the course materials are, where
so it's you can copy the course material from a directory on the virtual machine. So it's in this /server/data, there's all the material. Let me this up, yeah. So, and the part that concerns, so if you have unzipped all that stuff into your workshop directory, then there are three parts to the tutorial on molecular dynamics, parts 1, 2, and 3. And it's part 2 that pertains to the machine learning. So the PDFs of this and of the presentations of today are on this SharePoint, of which you have gotten a link, to which you've gotten a link from Jair. Should have gotten a link per email. Is it working or is there a problem? It's not working?
No, I see it.
Okay. Yes. So essentially, you need two things, right? When you start to work, let me also do this so that I can show it to you. So on the left, you have a file browser, right? On the left of the, yeah. So the most comfortable way to start is by opening one of these Python notebooks you find inside of the directory with all the files. So for instance, can open this one. And these notebooks should take you through the exercises step by step. So I propose that everybody simply goes through it at their own pace and at their own interest. And if there are questions, then simply put up a hand and I will come. So you will need a terminal and this notebook, right? A terminal to run the examples. So for instance, E04 is the first example in this part two notebook. And it will contain a description of the files and it will tell you at some point to change into the correct directory, so for this, and to start the calculation. I don't know if everybody is familiar with Python notebooks, so if you want to evaluate a certain cell, you enter it and then you push shift enter and that should activate the code in this cell. So. But first you would have to start the computation. That is. So are there people that have absolutely no experience with VASP at all? Yeah. So there are a few other tutorials that are on this drive. So I mean, you can start, of course, with the molecular dynamics tutorial if you want, but there are a few other ones as well. And there is one that is called Simple Bulk Systems. That would be another tutorial that you could try in the same manner as these. So you copy the necessary files to your drive. In this notebook, go through these steps and then you start with part one of molecules, for instance. We'll leave this machine on for a few days so that you could do this in the evening or tomorrow, or I think we'll switch it off on Sunday, so you will have ample time to go through whatever you'd like to do. running, very good. So if you have questions, so there's in the PDF of the presentation, there's a short description of and it mentions tags that are related to. So let's put it like this. So in the presentation, I stopped at some point. So there were a few more slides that mentioned the in-car tags that are related to machine learning. But essentially, everything is described on our wiki. So, but I will put up the link. I will go there. So if you go through our website, www.vasp.at, you'll find this here, the wiki. Yeah, we're trying to improve it. If you have suggestions and issues, then please I collect these things and we try to make it better. But everything concerning machine learned force fields is in. If you go through the category menu, there's something about machine learned force fields, and that essentially collects every. Thing, all tags and articles that are related to these force fields. So if you have maybe the most important tag would be, for instance, this one that switches on the machine learned force field. So that is where you could find additional information on the on the things that you find in, for instance, pop here. This is part of an in-car file, so there's some tags related to machine learning there, and you can search our wiki for their meaning. Well, in this case, the meaning is that you switch on machine learning and that you start from scratch. Thank you. because it's very, but it's not, the examples are not so exciting, maybe, but at least it will, yeah, it should try to pick you up at the end. Maybe just one thing that I didn't get to this point during my presentation before, but there's a connection that we can make that I would like to mention, a connection between these high-level methods that are so expensive of calculating total energies beyond DFT, calculating forces and stresses beyond DFT, and machine learning. And that is something that, well, it's not fully supported yet, not in a way that is convenient to use in the code, but it will be pretty soon. And that is delta machine learning. And just have one slide that I'd like to present. This is sort of something that is going to come and that might, bring the field forward. And that is the idea that you could machine learn the difference in the description of the total energy in the RPA and DFT. So you would, and you would hope that this difference, so that is the thing that you you see here. This is a total energy landscape, some parameter and total energy. And this would be the total energy in DFT. You see, it has a lot of features. And it's what's hard to sample, or you would have to costly to sample still. And you would could create a force field for that. And the hope would be that the difference between that total energy landscape and the one of a very costly method like RPA, that difference is much smoother, that it doesn't show so many features, so that it would actually be relatively easy, relatively cheap, to machine learn this difference. So that is the idea that underlies delta machine learning. So you would start out with a training for some method like DFT. You would do extensive training for that. And then you would take a subset of the structures. Or you could even create another data set, but a much reduced data set. And you would train the energy difference between RPA and DFT. You would train on a strongly reduced data set in the hope that that energy difference is much easier to learn because it has much less features. So you would get away with a lot of less descriptors, a lot of less training structures because you're training something that is easier to learn. Yeah, although each individual calculation would then be much, much more expensive because you would do this RPA stuff. But then you would get a machine learned force field for the energies and the forces and the stresses based on this energy difference. And so you would get energy differences in the forces and differences in the stresses between DFT and this higher, more advanced method. And then you would correct the initial DFT data set. All the energies and forces and stresses, you would correct by means of this delta machine learned force field, and you would end up with a corrected force field. So you would retrain your initial DFT thing, you would retrain, you would correct for this energy difference. And the hope is, of course, that you end up with a force field that has the quality in its description of energies, forces, and stresses of this higher order method. Yeah. Well, as we have seen in the presentation, that unfortunately RPA does not provide the final answer in terms of energies. This higher order method will, in all probability, be something different in the end, will be something different than RPA. Right now, it's pretty much the best that one can do realistically on realistic systems. But there's a lot of effort on the way, also within our group, to get even better energies and forces and what have you not, for instance. So there's a few people that are working on auxiliary field quantum Monte Carlo to do that. That looks very promising for energies. For the moment, there's still some trouble to get that to work for metallic systems. But once that is done, then you could, for instance, envision that you would train a force field based on essentially the difference between DFT and quantum Monte Carlo, or DFT and something like coupled cluster. Something that is outrageously expensive in its way, but you would only need to do it once to get the force field and then start using that. So that is something that we think might be the future for. So not only, of course, right now you could train a force field, get basically DFT description, and then start doing molecular dynamics on a much larger scale. So you could sample much longer time scales and things like this using the force field. But in essence, you're still getting results with the quality of DFT. So the force field is not bringing you further than the thing you train against. So in the end, you would like, of course, we would like to have a much more accurate description of total energies than you have in DFT. Okay.
Same answer, yes.
So maybe I can ask a question from the people that use VASP on a maybe more or less regular basis. What is the feature that you mostly miss that you would like? What should be there that is not there? Yes.
Include the magnetic moments in the last round book.
They are not there?
They are not there.
Oi. Okay. Yes. There must be more. Nobody misses anything. Wow. Yes.
When the local spy was printed out,
yeah.
Not too many options of what parts of the quantum potentials can be printed out.
Okay.
And, now, currently, you can print out the Hartree part.
Yes.
But the U value or any addition from the Valls box, I don't think it's included, which is really important to know all the contributions.
Okay. So to be able to get yes. Right. Okay. Yes. Yeah.
So it doesn't stop in one run. Several sequential runs come to play.
Yes. Yeah.
It's not a big deal, but every new student that comes, they don't understand why stopping is not really stopping.
Yeah. So I guess that it's mostly when you optimize the cell shape as well, right? Yes. Yeah. Yeah, it's very hard to do this inside of the program, because it's the difference between constant basis set optimization and constant energy cutoff optimization. So when you start with a certain cell with a certain volume, if you so want, the code constructs a basis set for this volume in accordance with the energy cutoff, and this data structure is so old and so central to the code, it's very hard to change it. But basically, it's not possible to change this data structure on the fly during the run. So if you now change the cell volume and you keep the basis set as it was, then essentially you are changing the cutoff. Yeah, that is the... So you're running at constant basis set, which means that you're running at a variable cutoff. So as your cell, for instance, expands, you're effectively decreasing the cutoff. So your cell shows some certain pressure and it grows during your optimization, the volume grows. Basis set vectors stay the same, but of course the reciprocal space vectors are shrinking because your cell is getting larger. So effectively your basis sets corresponds to a lower cutoff. So then. Exactly. Then you stop. Yeah. Then you stop. You get the structure. You restart. At that point, you get a different basis set, because it. Yeah. And the whole thing starts again because it sees. Okay. But for this cutoff, my true cutoff that I'm aiming for, I was not finished yet. So.
Maybe just
yes, we need to do that. That is yes. It is this. No, it is, yeah, and it's this thing that I always need to bend my mind around it myself to, but yes. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So there's two ways around it, of course. You can start at a large cutoff, so 30% larger than you would aim for. That should minimize this effect. The cell could contract, then you are going to a larger cutoff, effectively larger cutoff. But if you are already converged with respect to the cutoff, it should not make a difference anymore. But when is this? Yeah, you do not know if you don't, not beforehand, you don't know this. So, yes, and all these things, they are part of our lectures, and we want them to be part of the wiki. So essentially, we want all this information to be at the beginning of the categories. It's just that, you know, it's essentially the effort of writing a book, because there's a lot of, it combines some, this whole field combines so many different things, yeah, because then, of course, energy minimization routines, how they work, how you do this, how do you search for the lowest eigenvectors of a matrix, this iterative matrix diagonalization. There's a whole world of things behind it that are not collected anywhere in a single book. It would be good. But I agree, yes. It feels wrong, right? You complete your calculation and then you think, okay, that's the answer, and you restart it and it starts optimizing again. Yeah. That already exists. Yeah, I think it's a hidden feature in the sense that it's not documented, but it already exists. Yeah. So
can I just add to the PW numbers? Or no, that's to each other.
No, you would need to put something in the format of logpod. So it would be on the regular grid. You can add something to the potential. So in real space. Yeah. So as you get the potential in real space, you would add whatever you want to. Yeah.
So how is that
done? I have to look it up. It's a hidden feature also from me. yeah.
Because one package.
No, Marta, it's not possible yet. No. Sorry. I thought it was, but it's not.
That is an additional.
So I will get a cup of coffee, so this.
to pass the sun. It's actually an idea that we are working on to make it available on an on-demand basis. So, for instance, for students that want to learn something but they don't want for a license, so we would like to offer that some of this. So, it would be then smallish virtual machines, so you cannot start to production work set, but
okay.
Then it's explore the code, teach yourself some things and things like that.
So I think that Sunday, there's all these books just on the...
But how do you think you can download? The files that are there you can download.
Do they just tutorial also for...
Oh, they are online, so
online.
The notebooks, the Python notebooks,
okay.
Are available from the website.
Okay.
But you can copy it from the.
Okay, this Sunday you're
there. Yeah, that was the idea. So what we will do, we'll scale down the machine,
okay.
So it will have less cores. Then for this afternoon, it's just to reduce the cost of keeping it up a bit.
Did you pick on books? How can we download it? We cannot download it.
Yes, you can download them from the... you can download it from the file browser. I think you can, right? Copy download link. Download. Oh yeah, if you right click on any of the things you can download from if you want.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. But they're also available from the website. So if you go to if you go here to learn, there's the tutorials. So you can copy all that. So the only thing that you cannot get from there is the podcast files.
Ah,
okay.
So, but those you could copy from the drive. You can copy because they are strictly licensed. But and the other thing that the stuff that is used inside of notebooks you can also get from here. That is by us. So that is still a bit in the beginning, so we're going to expand on that creation.
So that is... Yeah, so these tutorials are available through the website. So this is our website. If you go to learn, there's a section on the tutorials. So those are the ones that we have currently published. There's an additional one is available on the virtual machine that you have access to now. That will keep up and running at least until Sunday. So we'll scale it down. It will have less cores than it has at the moment, but it will be open. So the accounts will be still active. And of course, you can copy anything you have from this file browser. I guess you can copy any and all files that you want and need. And the other thing that is used in the tutorials is within this Python notebook, is this Py4Wasp, and that should, it is in its infancy, so this is, I think, at version 0.4, so it is still a zero version, and it doesn't do much more at the moment than read stuff from the HDF5 output file, and you can look at structures and look at the density of states and band structure and things like that. So it has some useful capabilities, but we intend to really invest in this. So this should essentially go into the direction of workflow management. That would be the idea. It uses biomet. So I think Biomagen, as far as somebody told me that the API is completely changed now, as of recently, something like this. I think they have a new website. Just came online last week, I think. And, okay. Yeah. Yeah, so there's the next generation of materials project, I think. So, with workflow management, it's hard to know what will prevail, right? So it's hard to be complete in any way, right? So support submission of things to supercomputers it's hard to say where. On the other hand, there's of course the AIDA world, where it's pretty hard to write plugins, I must say. So we're not so sure yet where to go with that. Would be if somebody has a brilliant idea, we're happy to hear it. Happy to steal it. No. But it's hard to say what will prevail, right? So, of course, within the materials project, there's a lot of workflow management already available, which is great. Maybe one other thing, because nobody asks for features. We are hopefully by the end of the year, and probably by the end of the year, we'll have electron phonon coupling available. So, and that's one of the things that calls for workflow management. So, it's those calculations. They bring a lot. You have supercell calculations and primitive cell calculations. So you immediately run into that different basis set problem. It's very hard to do that within the code, unfortunately. Right. So, and how would you specify the observable? How would you envision?
I think the user can calculate the target zone. He gets the vector of the taking state and any observable position.
Right. And you'd like this in real space or in yeah. Yeah. So essentially, you would like the Hamiltonian within the basis of the orbitals. So
it doesn't have to be the Hamiltonian, but yes, specifically the coupling elements are you like the ideal of it?
Yeah. So as soon as it has been diagonalized, it would be the eigenvalues, right? Yeah. So it would be the eigenvalues. Yes. So if you would, I don't know, one-year-ize the, if you would do a maximal localization of something like that. Yeah. 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 Yeah, the
in other the chemistry community, like you can calculate the diagonals that in the calculate.
Yeah. No, but I guess your point is that you don't want this per se for the Hamiltonian, because for the Hamiltonian you have this information. It's the eigenvalues. You only would need to make rotations, and then you would have essentially the.
Yeah, if it was just Hamiltonian, that's not a specific reason, because I don't, the user cannot rotate the.
No, you would have to do this outside of the code essentially, but the necessary information would be there, because you would have the eigenvalues. Yes. In outcar file, for instance, there's a vector of eigenvalues. Well, I think well, as a vector, they're definitely in the XML file. Yeah. But this should become really much more interesting in this Python environment. So they are also written to the HDF5 file, so it should be easier to get these into Python data structures and then to manipulate them. But of course, if you want expectation values of, I don't know, the kinetic energy operator only, then it becomes more difficult. That needs to be done inside of the code. Yeah, but not within the PRW method, because you will always have this. Yeah, but not. Yeah, but then you have only the pseudo part of the wave function. You don't have. If that is enough, then, but that does not even have the correct norm, right? So it's. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, because to get the PRW wave function on a regular grid is not possible, the true wave function, so including the nodal behavior that is carried by the one center terms, that you cannot represent on any regular grid. It would be too dense. Okay, you don't care about the PL. Okay, yeah. Yeah. Okay. That can be done. Yes. Yeah. No, I see your point, yeah. So the pseudo part of the wave function can be printed out. That can be done.
for the hopping matrix element, there should be really not a problem from the correct linear combinations of the And for just any local operator, it becomes more difficult to either you take the wave functions to do it for the pseudo part only yourself, if you so want.
It's post-processing. As long as you can give me the wave function, I can run it.
Yes, we would like to. Yes.
possible.
Yeah, so we will leave the virtual machine online. So the machine that you have been working on will remain open for you, and the accounts will remain active at least until Sunday. So you will have time to explore at your own leisure.